We are the wind in the sails of your business. We are your compass. Chart your course towards your targets. Africa Business Radio. Towards a profitable Africa.
The agreement that establishes the African Continental Free Trade Area was adopted by the member state of the African Union in March 2018, and the date of the last signatory was October 2019. It is a flagship project of the African Union's Agenda 2063, a blueprint for attaining inclusive and sustainable development across the continent of Africa over the next 50 years. 55 African countries merging into a single market of 1.3 billion people. This agreement creates the largest trading bloc in the world with regards to the number of countries, with a combined GDP of $3.4 trillion. It is described as a vehicle for economic transformation of Africa. The AfCFTA, with the objective to accelerating intra-African trade and boosting Africa's trading position in the global market by strengthening Africa's common voice and policy space in global trade negotiations. As this agreement became officially operational on January 1, 2021, Wilson Erumebor, a senior economist at the Nigerian Economic Summit Group, is here with me and will be chatting about what this agreement means for Nigerian businesses and how to take advantage of the opportunities that the agreement offers. Before we get into the conversation further, you are an economist, and I want to get from the perspective of an economist, a free trade agreement, what does that sound like when you bring it to the context of economy?
Well, what it basically means is that over time, countries would get to liberalize their trade environment, and that basically means that you allow for more imports and you allow for exports as well. So there are what we call tariff barriers and non-tariff barriers. So you're basically removing all the necessary barriers to trade to allow for free flow of goods from one country to another within a specified block. The fact that the agreement entails that countries would, over time, within a specified period, start to remove all the relevant trade barriers and even non-trade barriers, you know, so that countries can export goods, you know, easily from one, you know, point to another. It also entails export of services, trade of services. It also entails movement of people from one part of the continent to another. So it's basically easing flow of goods and people within a specified area.
Okay, now, the narrative when it comes to Africa is the fact that we have not been trading among ourselves. You know, we are trading more with outsiders than, of course, fellow African countries and all that. So, I'm not looking at, you know, how this particular agreement was born. What do you think were the main objectives of this particular agreement, other than, you know, the general advantages around a free trade agreement?
So for the AfCFTA, one of the primary reasons, and if you look at data, like you mentioned, intra-African trade within Africa is just about 16%, you know, of total trade. And that tells you that's probably one of the lowest amongst all the different trading blocks we have across the world. So that tells you that Africa itself, we're not doing much in exporting goods amongst ourselves or to ourselves, you know. One other thing you'd look at is also the size of the continent in terms of GDP. We're looking at a $3.4 trillion economy in terms of the African continent. We're looking at a population of, you know, close to 1.3 billion people and all that. So if you then look at how Africa relates to the rest of the world, as much as we contribute, you know, close to 16% of total population, and if you look at the GDP and even trade, it accounts for less than 3% of global output and global trade. That tells you that there's a lot more Africa needs to do to get to trade within itself to ensure that we can ease barriers, because the proponent of this deal and some of the key factors that, you know, led to the birth of this is that there's the agenda 2063 that the African Union at the time, you know, had them set for a long-term period. And one of the key things is to see how we can have a unified Africa, in the sense that every African, wherever you go, you are treated equal, you have equal opportunities with people. So it allows for innovation, it allows for competition, and ultimately it would address some of the core developmental issues of unemployment and poverty that Africa has been faced with for decades.
All right, now on the note of unemployment and poverty, which is a major problem of Africa, now bringing this agreement into operation right now, like I mentioned in my intro, January 1st, you know, businesses can start trading on the basis of this agreement. Everything seems to be quiet. What do you think is happening?
Well, like we all know, it's COVID. I mean, for now, everybody's still, you know, trying to be cautious, especially given the experience we've had from 2020. It's still, there's even a second wave, you know, in Europe and even in Nigeria and in so many other African countries. So there's this need for people to also be cautious. Even investors, as of now, are also trying to, you know, understand and see the environment, you know, before they can make some critical investment moves. Yes, we will have to eventually devise means of living with the virus. You know, there's been recent improvements in the area of vaccine development and administration. So that, those are some positive things. But over time, people are still very cautious. Consumers are cautious as well. You don't want to spend so much at this time, you know, buying luxury things. Investors at the same time are also cautious. Even government is also trying as much as possible, you know, across Africa to see how they can stimulate investment, stimulate aggregate demand. So the AfCFTA falling and coming into effect at this time, I would look at it as an opportunity, as a deal that, you know, probably could even trigger the sense of recovery that Africa needs at the time. Because, like you know, so many African countries are, a lot of them are in recession. Many have recorded negative GDP growth either in the third and fourth quarter of 2020. So unemployment rates, poverty rates are all increasing. At the government revenues, even to provide stimulus package for businesses, is still a major challenge across the continent. So what it means now is that, yes, your agreement is in effect, but at the same time, people are also being careful, you know, given the pandemic and its effect.
Now, talking about the pandemic, the African Business Council, which is the private sector umbrella across the continent, they issued a statement in support of the trade pact and all that. Now, talking about the businesses that are operating across the countries, member countries actually now, what are the things that you think they're supposed to start doing right now? I understand that a lot of people don't understand the details about the agreement as yet, but what should people start doing, businesses actually?
I think first thing first is to read and understand what the details of the agreement is. Coming into effect, there are different phases. Phase one is what is now operational, and that basically means that the trade in goods protocol and the trade in service protocol, as well as the settlement of disputes. So those three aspects are, you know, have come into effect on the 1st of January. And so what that means is that countries would, you know, start to liberalize some of those things. And the agreement, particularly for trading goods, basically entails that countries over time within a 10-year period would liberalize their tariff line. So there's countries have this tariff line, and 90% of those tariff lines, you know, of the goods they import would be liberalized. That means tariff on those goods will be removed. For countries that are above the LDC status, they would, after the next 5 years to 10-year period, they will have to remove, for the sensitive list, about 7% of some of these tariffs. So the basic thing is for businesses to position themselves, look at the areas within the course of the year, countries and governments will start releasing some of these areas where they would have to, you know, cut tariffs. So it's basically looking how you can position your business, how you can leverage on some of the opportunities. For instance, how prepared are you to compete with, you know, businesses in other regions within your area of specialization? How ready are you to export some of your goods to some of these African countries? Have you even gone through some of the list and the requirements, you know, in terms of standards and all that, to be able to leverage on some of the opportunities that exist across the market?
On the note of the standard, so what I've seen also is that the tariff barrier is there, but the standard barrier is also there, which in many cases also there is tendency to be for prejudice to actually come into play, you know, based on what I've seen. You see, this country say, okay, this is our standard, and they will scrutinize product from this particular country more rigorously than the other country. But, you know, the tariff is actually quite friendly. How is the agreement going to address that? Because also that's a major problem in Africa.
Yes, so it will have to, in most cases, there will be negotiations. Negotiations, I believe, will still be something that would kick on, that would still
so
be
So you mean
on.
There will be bilateral paths coming into play also?
Yes, of course, that's very important in any trade deal. We've seen, you know, there are cases, we even have regional trade blocks within the continent who also have different rules. But what the AfCFTA provides is that where there are, you know, clashes, so in cases where the AfCFTA would then, you know, supersede some of those cases. But in terms of standards, I think this is also very important. There's also an African standards, you know, organization that basically has some of the standards organization across the different countries. And I think it's even very important, and this is one of the benefits, I think, of the AfCFTA, is that countries also need to set some of these standards. It's Africa needs to move beyond accepting everything, whether it's coming from outside. You don't have specific standards, specific guidelines on products. Even in Nigeria, we've seen several cases where you export goods to Europe and then they are banned, they are prevented from coming in because some of these countries also have specific standards. And it's basically driven by the health condition of the people. They don't want things that would come in, you know, to their country and prevent people from falling ill and prevent certain type of ailments and all that. So I think African government, we need to start paying serious attention to standards. In Nigeria, yes, we have the standards organization, but you and I know that
enforcement of the standard.
Exactly. We have a very large informal economy. The point that some of the rice, the gari, the tomatoes
coming through,
who checks them, who actually certifies them? But it's not going to be accepted if in other countries. I've heard of several cases a couple of years ago where beans, the chemical content in the beans exported from Nigeria to, I think, the UK, it was so high that they said it could even hurt and kill humans. But it's something that even it consumed within Nigeria and even in other African countries. So I think this presents an opportunity for us to start looking at how we can enforce some of these standards. There are also some private certified companies that provide certifications. Maybe at this point, the government needs to start seeing how we can work with some of these companies, because that's what basically is done, you know, in some of the advanced countries.
So are you saying that the trade pact might not be the ultimate solution that has been projected to be?
Well, it has its potential, but I think what,
it's a lot of drawbacks.
Yes, so it depends on countries and governments of Africa to see how they can enforce some of these regulations. I mean, if you look at Nigeria, we've had issues of standards. There's so many stories you can hear about chemicals, you know, in certain products that we consume in Nigeria, which is not even friendly for humans. So I think, yes, the opportunity is there, but it's left for governments to enforce and make regulations to ensure that people comply.
Okay, so now let's talk about who the supposed winners of this trade pact could be. Of course, there have been conversations around, oh, this country has a bigger manufacturing potential than this other country. But when you look at the absolute numbers, you will probably see that actually this country is actually also not doing badly. So who are the supposed winners of this trade pact?
So ideally, in any trade pact, is those that are, you know, more prepared than the others. And there are several indicators you can look at. I mean, if you look at the global competitiveness ranking, you get to see countries that are competitive, you know, that have competitive economies. And Nigeria, sadly, is not among the top 100. I think we are about 115 in the world. But you have several African countries, particularly the North African countries, and then South Africa, Rwanda, and some other countries that are also on the top of that list. If you then also look at Trade Readiness Index, Nigeria is, you know, at the bottom of that list. The World Bank released a report recently that, cited some of the opportunities and, risk regarding the deal. And one thing was very clear, that countries that would benefit are those that in the past have made clear reforms to position their exports for competitiveness, clear reforms to support growth of local businesses and ensure export readiness of those businesses. So it's not just enough to support growth in output. There has to be a targeted policy at improving exports. Some countries even go as far as creating market for businesses. They send their ambassadors, they send their, foreign consulate offices to negotiate and create market. Even in Nigeria, I mean, that happens. You see a lot of Chinese government officials. It's not a coincidence. It's deliberate, because they have seen the opportunities that exist in this market. If you then look at the value of industry, the size of industry value added, the size of the manufacturing sector, like you pointed earlier. So on top of that list in Africa, you have Algeria. After Algeria, you have, South Africa. Then you have Egypt. Nigeria is fourth on that list. And then you have Morocco. So if you then come down to look at share of non-oil exports, because one key thing about Africa is that what we basically export to the rest of the world now is in primary product. And even within ourselves, we still do a lot more of primary product, So I think this deal presents an opportunity for a country like Nigeria, for instance, to grow its non-oil exports, which currently accounts for about 7% of total exports, which is, I mean, it's a characteristic of one of the less developed countries, if I may, because 7% of what you export is non-oil. And that tells you that you don't have a strong industrial base that can actually feed or compete with, other countries. So not to sound like a doomsday. But the key message here is that, yes, there will be gainers, there will be losers. Mm. And it also depends largely on how the government of that country positions itself to take advantage of the opportunities.
Now, the big question for me, is Nigeria ready to take advantage of this?
From an economist's point of view, I don't think we are. We certainly are not, especially when you look at the data. Now, there are several things I'll jump to a question with.
Okay.
And there are several things that a country must do.
Okay.
Let's hear those. And I think for Nigeria, I don't think we've done so much. There's been so much work around the deal itself. There's a National Action Committee trying to put a few things together, but we are not there
the
yet.
The internal reforms needed has not been done.
We've not done that yet. So one of the things is capacity of your local industries. You must be able to stimulate production. And it's not just production for exports, because that's what this AfCFTA is also about. And if you look at the data for Nigeria, less than 1% of our non-oil product is what we export. So what that basically means is, when you break down GDP into oil and non-oil, now that share of non-oil, how much of it do we export, is less than 1%. That's sad. So it tells you that we have a lot to do in terms of supporting businesses, small businesses, to grow, to have target markets. And this is something countries like China, for instance, did when they were growing. Countries like Singapore, they what they did was to identify these industries, set up standards for these industries, supported local businesses, targeted markets. Some countries don't even have, they don't even need what they produce. But because country B needs it, they produce for that market. So I think those are the things that we need to start doing now to leverage some of the opportunities of the deal.
Some will argue that we've done better in terms of exporting services. Is that correct?
Yes. So even in terms of what we export in Africa, Nigeria is still, is it second? Okay, maybe first, second in terms of services. But the challenge with services is that we don't even know the value of services that we export in Nigeria. Now,
we're not capturing that in
exactly,
our economic data.
And that leads to the second point of data, which is one of the things countries need to do to get ready. Because if you look at, go to the NBS website and you download exports trade data, it's called foreign trading in goods.
Yes.
You'd notice a breakdown of the goods we export from Nigeria to other countries, what we import, the value and all that. But you wouldn't find trade in services. Who are we exporting these services to? Yes, we hear a lot of talk about Nigeria being, Nigerian banks, being all over the continent, Nigerian businesses setting up in Kenya, particularly in the ICT space and all that. Oh, fantastic news. Good. But I think we need to move a step beyond just news to capturing the data of services we import and services we export. Because, mind you, we import a lot of services, and a couple of reports have even showed that imports of services is higher than export of services in Nigeria. So those are one thing we also need to pay attention to.
Could it also be that as a country, because we don't have adequate data to paint the right picture, could it be that our economy is doing better than we know?
Could it also be that we're doing worse than...
Well, it could be,
it's a coin. You can flip it the other way around. But what's more important is get the data. Because data should be driving policy.
Correct.
Data should be driving decision. You're going into a trade deal, for instance, and we don't have, as we speak now, Nigeria does not have a trade policy. You know, and this is something that is even... I mean, there's been several revised in 2012.
What is our lawmakers doing?
Well, I don't know. But it's something that even beyond the lawmakers, because a policy document may not even necessarily be legislative. You can have a policy document developed by the executive.
Okay.
So I know there's been efforts going on to get one, but I don't think we should keep doing effort when a deal has started now. We should get this policy documents ready. Because what it does is, number one, it sends signals to the business environment. You're able to target specific products, specific sectors, and you say, these are my priority sectors. This is the plan for the sectors within the next 2, 3, 4 years. This is how we will support businesses that operate within these sectors, whether it's in goods or it's in services. So I think having all the relevant policy document, policy instrument ready, and that's the third thing Nigeria needs to do, or a country needs to do, to be trade ready. The first is capacity, the second is data, and the third is getting all the relevant policy instruments ready. The fourth, I guess your question would lead me to that.
All right, I've got two more questions now. First, what would be the success metrics for the entire continent in the next 5 years with regards to this agreement?
Yeah, I think one of the key things would be statistics I cited earlier, one of them is the fact that what is intra-African trade. As at now, it's about 16%. Some would say it's 15, some would say it's 18. One of the reports said it's 15 to 18%. But in the next 2 to 3 years, would it have improved? Would it have gone to 30%, 40% and all that? But and we must also remember that trade is not just for trade. Trade has also is a means to an end, as much as it is an end in itself. So what I mean is that better trade must also lead to reduction in unemployment. It must also lift people out of poverty. It must also lead to increase in output, increase in GDP, increase in opportunities across the countries, ensure free flow of people as well, free flow of goods within the continent and all that. So those are some key metrics that I think as we go forward, we should be looking out for. Also, it's also important, that trade also leads to improvement in quality of life, improvement in infrastructure, which is the fourth point that a country must do to be trade ready. If you look at the ports, for instance, in Nigeria, the traffic around port access roads tells you that a lot more still needs to be done to get goods from one point to another with ease.
Okay. Now, I want to talk about the banking and the issue of currency with regards to the agreement.
Yeah.
There are stories that a couple of banks have been approved or appointed across different countries to be the settlement banks.
Yeah.
Of course, the Africa Import and Export Bank will be the overall settlement bank, but a couple of other banks across different countries, and we have in our own country, Nigeria, Zenith Bank and another one. So talk us through that. And in terms of currency, I also heard that there won't be a third-party currency in this case. There won't be like the US dollar coming to place in terms of the trade.
Yes, but those are things that I think that, yes, for now, because of course the agreement just came into effect now.
That's correct.
And you can't expect that whatever medium is proposed would also come in. Those are things that I believe would take more time before they begin to come into effect. And mind you, even at the end of the AfCFTA, there are plans to also have a single currency, you know, across the regional blocks and eventually across Africa. So I think these are issues that perhaps we will still understudy them to see as we go along, to see how they would turn out, how they would eventually play out, because nobody knows what exactly is going to, the deal is going, especially in terms of even the impact and the operations. It's a process and it's a journey. And as we keep going along, I think countries would also learn and, you know, negotiate better, because there's also room for countries to keep negotiating in case you are not satisfied with one area or the other. Yeah. So, and also in the second phase, which basically looks at intellectual property investment and all that, I think those are areas that are still quite new.
Gray
areas. Even in services, how do you even measure services? The fact that some countries don't even have data on services they import and export, or what they don't even understand, what many countries don't even understand how to capture some of these data. So I think there are still gray areas within the deal that over time, as we go along, we would keep understanding them and unraveling how best to approach some of these things.
For startups and small businesses across the continent, is there any opportunities? We probably would not have capacity for export and all that. Is there any opportunities in agreement?
Well, I think you can, over time, build capacity. Capacity is not something that happens, you know, immediately. I think for now, there are opportunities to keep searching. I've seen many startups, even there's some that even export goods, even outside the continent, to the UK, to the US. I mean, starting from somewhere. Some started by just shipping a box and making losses. And at some point, over time, they were able to build a customer base and export to some of these countries. So I think one thing is very key. Understand the deal. Understand the market in which you target, you seek to operate in. If you know something is needed in a country, check to be sure that you meet whatever standard is set within the country, or you can meet the standard. You know, reach out to people who do business in that country. Ideally, Nigerian embassies in those other countries should have an economic desk that should be providing help to Nigerian businesses that operate, or to even businesses that want to operate in those markets, because that's basically what the foreign desk of other countries do in Nigeria. So I think from a policy and institutional perspective, that's something that maybe institutions that, you know, are at the forefront of these negotiations also need to put in place, because this is very important for small businesses. Perhaps also creating a hub. Maybe some of the startups can create something online that gets to educate people on the opportunities that exist in, say, Ghana, in Cote d'Ivoire. How can we get prepared? What are the markets? What are the products that is needed in those countries? And I think businesses would certainly, you know, if they do this, they would certainly be at the front of the benefits of this deal.
Yeah, that's a good one. I think we have to stop here. If we continue, there's so much to talk about with regards to the agreement.
Yeah.
But possibly we're able to have a part two of this conversation. We'll see in the future. But thank you so much for joining me today. Yeah. Any final remark from you?
Well, I think I'd say that it's a journey. It's a process that has started. But our government really, really need to be serious. And be serious, you know, not necessarily mean running around trying to say we are working on. This time, we should get things moving. We should have a trade policy. We should get data. We should kickstart the collection of data across all the areas that we trade in. We should have priority areas, priority products, you know, and so that we can protect our local industries. Yes, we are opening up, removing tariffs, removing non-trade tariffs, but we can also support our businesses to dominate the environment in Africa. And Nigeria is at the forefront of it. So are other countries. Yeah, so countries and governments must ensure that they take the necessary moves to make them ready for this deal.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. That was Mr. Wilson. He's a senior economist with the Nigerian Economic Summit Group. I believe they also have a couple of reports around this agreement. And like he said, what you should be doing right now as a business owner or as an entrepreneur is to go ahead and understand the agreement, seek knowledge about the agreement. And of course, you will see also areas where there will be or there is opportunities for you. And for us, it's goodbye.
We are the wind in the sails of your business. We are your compass. Chart your course towards your targets. Africa Business Radio. Towards a profitable Africa.